My name is Michael McHale. I am the Division Director of Gynecologic Oncology at UCSD Morris Cancer Center. So gynecologic cancer is a malignancy that has originated from one of the gynecologic organs. So that can include the uterus, it can include the cervix, the vagina, the vulva, the fallopian tubes of the ovaries. So some of the cancers are a little bit more challenging in that the signs and symptoms are a little more subtle. They may be a little bit more indolent. Sometimes they can be confused with other non-malignant conditions. So specifically, ovarian cancer is one of the more challenging gynecologic cancers because a lot of the symptoms are, as I mentioned, indolent in the sense that some vague bloating, some vague distension, maybe occasional twinge or pain within the abdomen or pelvis. And these may be symptoms that a woman has had throughout her life. But what should be a red flag to seek out attention is if any of those things did exist previously and now subsequently they're more consistent, they may be more intense. And those are warnings or flags that would necessitate a visit to whether it's your primary care physician or your gynecologist. There are other cancers, such as endometrial cancer, that there are some very common hallmark signs and symptoms. And so for a woman who is postmenopausal, who has not had any vaginal bleeding since becoming menopausal, if they were to suddenly start noticing spotting or bleeding or a vaginal discharge that has not been present since they cycled previously, those are usually signs and symptoms of potentially an abnormality within the lining of the uterus. And it could be a precancerous change called hyperplasia, or it could be a malignancy. And they should seek attention with their gynecologist. And that attention should include an exam or an ultrasound and potentially a biopsy of the lining of the uterus called endometrial biopsy. With respect to cervical cancer, some of the more common signs or symptoms associated with this particular malignancy that starts on the cervix is bleeding that may occur at the time of intercourse. And frequently, cervical cancers are identified because this is a new symptom that patients present to their primary care physician or gynecologist with, or they have their routine cervical cancer screening that identifies a change within the cells that make up or line the surface of the cervix. And then lastly, vulvar cancers are frequently missed because patients will oftentimes develop symptoms that they just ignore. They think it's part of the normal aging process, and that can include a new onset of pruritus, so itching or burning within the vulva. And frequently, these are treated or self-treated with topical agents that they may purchase at a local pharmacy. But if these symptoms persist, they too should seek attention with either their primary care physician or their gynecologist so that a more appropriate exam could be completed to make a more appropriate diagnosis. There are a number of screening strategies that are available for women today that have been very successful. In fact, probably the best screening strategy that we have in medicine is to receive a pap smear. And today, that has evolved since it was first introduced decades ago. And now, that pap smear, depending on the age, will also include assessing for the human papillomavirus. And we know that that virus is directly linked to the development of both precancerous and cancerous changes of the cervix, as well as the vagina, as well as the vulva. I implore women to seek out regular gynecologic exams and to also seek out well-prescribed screening strategies that have been developed by a number of authoritative organizations that have used scientific data to support these particular screening intervals. And again, that will include a pap smear, and it also will include an assessment of the human papillomavirus depending on age. You know, one of the best prevention strategies that we have for gynecologic cancers pertains to the reduction of cervical cancer and pre-invasive disease of the cervix, as well as the vagina and the vulva. And that really came about with the introduction of one of the earlier HPV vaccines that covered four of the more common HPV subtypes, HPV 6, 11, and 16 and 18. And this was introduced in the United States in the mid-2000s. And it was fairly clear from some of the earlier trials that it was efficacious in terms of reducing not only the risk for pre-invasive disease of the cervix, as well as cervical cancers. Fortunately, and with a great deal of effort to expand the number of HPV viruses that one can be protected against, that vaccine now covers 9 of the more common HPV subtypes. And clearly, the data would support the utilization and the prescription of this vaccine for both young girls and young adult women, as well as boys and young adult men. If a woman's diagnosed with gynecologic cancer, they should seek an expert opinion and in consultation with a gynecologic oncologist. A gynecologic oncologist has been trained in both OB-GYN and then they've continued their training in gynecologic oncology for an additional 3 to 4 years. And as such, they are the experts at managing gynecologic malignancies. And that includes from a surgical perspective, from an adjunctive therapy perspective, which could include immunotherapy, could include chemotherapy, it could also include radiation therapy. But they really should be the quarterback of your management because they are the experts at managing the spectrum of gynecologic malignancies.